You got to be pretty strong to break that thing open. And so coconut charcoal is like 10 times better than standard activated charcoal. All right? And it even is activated itself because it's so hard. Oh, you've done that? Oh, by the way, we get...
I didn't get it printed yet.
You haven't got it yet. Okay, but we're going to, right? Okay. Okay, we're going to get a thumb drive, but a lot of people wanted some handouts. I did actually make a handout, but I'm not sure where the handout went to, and so I have it on computer, and we're going to try to get this handout to you because it's got some recipes, some of the things that we've been showing you. I wanted to make sure that people got it. I think there's a hand up, and I'll get to you. They use a lot of heat. In fact, it's for coconut charcoal, it's about 1,100 degrees
heat.
And without oxygen. And then right at the end, they use oxygen to impregnate it with small holes. And that creates little caves in the charcoal to help bind. So they can only do that for a short time because otherwise you destroy the charcoal's efficiency. Okay, we got it. Good. All right. Shall I get that back for you?
You got so many running.
I know, I got too many here. Here we go. So, great. Thank you. Someone else had a question. Yes.
What quantity of the activated charcoal would you use, since you said it's more efficacious?
Yeah. Right. You only need, what I did is, because activated coconut charcoal, I'll be honest with you, is very expensive. But for value for money, it's actually more efficacious because it's so powerful. So if you were go online, you'll pay like $20 for 8 ounces of coconut charcoal plus shipping and so on. So what I did, because most people don't really need that much, don't need a big container, I just put it in 4 ounce containers. But you would only need, let's say you got inflammation in the body, you may only need 1 teaspoon of coconut charcoal. And your standard charcoal, you know, your activated charcoal that you see, that's often from hardwoods. Hardwoods is one of the best woods. The eucalyptus tree actually is very good. Now they're making charcoal out of bamboo as well. Bamboo is almost as good as coconut. Almost, it's pretty expensive, yeah.
Are you going to talk about how to take it? Because I've heard some people, I knew somebody tried to take the dry one.
You don't want to do that. You don't want to do that. And I put on my labels, open with care, because this stuff, now the good thing about this type of charcoal is that it's super fine, and when you put it in a cup and drink it, it's not gritty like you got sandpaper in there. And because it's so small powder, and I'm afraid to share this with you. if I pour it around, we could be in trouble. But you can come up and have a look at it. It is very fine powder.
It's like black talcum powder.
It's like black talcum powder. You know, just imagine black talcum powder. It's very small, and it's good for children, too. In fact, even if you don't have coconut charcoal, you can use standard charcoal. And what I would do is I would
sniff of it to see if it's still,
still activated. You're going to get me in trouble. Send me in some lawyer's office soon. What you do is you get 1 tablespoon. If you've got your standard charcoal at home, take 1 tablespoon, mix it in a cup of water, and then you'll see a slurry on the top, like a skin. Take that off. Okay, now you've got to wait for several hours before all the sediment goes at the bottom and the film goes to the top. So it's good to do it at night. Take the skin off the top and then pour the middle part into another cup. And that's what we call colloidal charcoal. And colloidal really is to do with small particles. It's suspended in the water. And if you hold it up to the light, you'll see little shimmers of light. That's the colloidal charcoal. And children won't know it's not water. You know, and that's really good for Persian carpets. It's good for nice beds that you want to preserve. Okay. It's clean, that's what I'm saying. It's not going to mess up everything with black stains. Since charcoal is very messy. Very, very messy. It takes longer for us to clean up the charcoal than it's just, I mean, it's unbelievable. Yes. You can still use it. It depends. If you open up, if you just left the top off this, it will sucking everything in the room. Over time, charcoal will deactivate. You can actually reactivate charcoal that's old by heating it up in an oven. You know, if you've had it for, let's say, 5 years and it's stored well, you can still use it. Yeah. Oh, if you're using it with medication, or just a charcoal capsule. Okay, the charcoal capsule, do you mean the tablet, or do you mean the thin, like, veggie cap? Okay, you can do that. Here's the thing with capsules. Some people's digestion is so poor, they can't break down the capsule. And so it doesn't work that well. Tablets can also work the same way. And as we get older, our body produces less hydrochloric acid. And as you get older, in fact, we give older people more tablets as they get old, right? But they have less efficiency because their digestive system is so much weaker. And so it's hard for them to absorb that. So what's the difference? Not much difference. Usually, usually it does get broken down, veggie cap. And usually it's the amount, you know, you've got to take more. So you'd take maybe 8 little veggie caps for 1 tablespoon of charcoal, something like that. Yes?
Don't they usually use sugar to make the tabs to hold?
In the binding agents, they can use binders, yes. And so they use fibrous material, and it actually is often more material in the binding agents than it is in the charcoal itself. So you may only be getting 1/3 of the charcoal in tablet form that you could get from the powder form. All right? So, what I prefer to use charcoal with, because charcoal and water will just dry out very quickly. Now, you can use it in an emergency, but I prefer to use psyllium over even flaxseed. Now, you can use flaxseed. There's nothing wrong with using flaxseed. It's quite fine to use that. But it does take longer time if you've got the whole seed and you haven't got a grinder. A grinder, you can speed things up a little. But you have to wait for that mucilaginous substance to come out of the flax in order to help bind that. So with psyllium, you don't need to heat. You don't need anything. You just pour it in the cup and you stir it up until it goes hard. And it goes like a little bit like a jelly type substance, and it's really easy to slap on, and it's easy to get off. It's actually easier to get off than flax. Sometimes if you put it on the skin, you got to be careful. If you've got open wounds, it can tattoo the skin, so be careful on that. You can do direct application. Let's say you want to detox the liver, you put it over the liver and you wrap it with cellophane around, and you can leave it overnight. Usually about 8 hours is what we used to use it for, and then take it off.
I drew out a tumor, so it lacks out first, but used psyllium.
And
it was about as deep as half of my thumb. But when I used psyllium, it didn't tattoo the wound at all.
Yeah.
Flax is more likely to tattoo an open wound.
Yeah, good point.
Psyllium's a good clean.
Yeah, it is. I love it. You can slap it on, take it off very quickly. Yes. Yeah, actually, we're going to do that right now. Would you like to come up? You were volunteering, right? Okay, all right, thank you. Okay, we got some activated coconut charcoal here. And, all right, I'm going to take this off for you. And make sure you're not watching TV and you haven't got a plate in the other hand when you do this, okay? All right. So we can actually put that on here. And what I want you to do very carefully is put one big scoop of that in here. All right. Okay, very good. Now, no, we're not going to put the water yet. Thank you. Okay. Why we're not going to do that is because it's going to go up in the air. So we're going to cover it. Actually, we need another. We just one. Actually, it was a heaped teaspoon is what we use for this.
Teaspoon
is what we use. Now, if someone could get me a plate. Sorry, I've run out of spoons here. Maybe what I'll do. Let me see. Yeah, let me paper towel. Yeah, we got a roll. Let me use that. It will just, hang on, let me, just, it's fine. All right. And I don't mind if we get a little bit in there. So yeah, even stains the spoon. All right, so, and we're gonna, yeah, we're actually, with this size, we're gonna use two big, okay. And make sure you sprinkle it over the top. That's it. All right. Okay, thank you. And then we're going to fill up like half a cup here with that water.
All right.
That's psyllium. Psyllium husk powder is what you're using. And that's good. And I want you to slowly stir that in. Okay, just slowly. Half a cup of water. You can use psyllium in food. It's good sometimes used in a smoothie. Those who are trying to maybe lose weight and you would like to still feel full, psyllium is a good one for that. But you also have to drink a lot of water. Psyllium without water is not good. It can plug you up. And how's it going? It's, yeah, we're going to add some more water. Didn't want to add too much because wanted to make sure it was all together. Okay. All right. It's coming, isn't it? That's good. She's doing a great job. Do this somewhere where you know, it's safe to do it. This charcoal goes up in the air, goes everywhere. I remember one time we had a lady that had really, really bad skin. I mean, her skin was like lizard skin. It was terrible. And we gave her a charcoal bath. Actually, we had one of the ladies that poured all this charcoal in the bath and gently rubbed her skin. And you couldn't believe when you saw her the next day. Oh, thank you. Great. Appreciate it. When we went back, saw her the next day, it was like a different person. It was like baby skin. It was just amazing. It was just like all that scales had come off. You wouldn't think so. Yeah, okay, that's good. That's good. That's good. So it's come to like a little paste here. It's pretty sort of thick, and yet it's wet. And what you do is you put that on like a... one of these kitchen rolls, and you can put it directly over the area that you know you've got inflammation on, and then you can wrap it if you want, or tape it, either way.
So you could put a little bit of that on that.
You got
this
some
unknown. We don't know what those are. But if you put that and I wrapped it,
you can try.
The doctor doesn't know.
Yeah,
it just popped up.
Is it spreading? Is it?
Well, he had it on that.
It came up three times right there, and then
very sore.
Three weeks later, one popped up there.
Okay.
So could we? That's painful.
You could try it, but you're gonna have to leave it on like overnight. It's not gonna see instantaneous results.
No, but a couple times.
Yeah, if you want to pass it around.
Don't
Now, you can eat charcoal. It's no problem with eating charcoal. And what's the difference with eating charcoal? Why would you eat charcoal and why would we put it externally on it? Okay, this is how it works. Anything external that we have inflammatory-wise, you want to put it directly on that particular part of the body. It has more direct relationship with that. Now, if there's something internal, let's say you have a stomach. I'll get you in 1 second. If you have, say, indigestion or you had some diarrhea or maybe you had some intestinal gas or something like that, then you can take it internally because it's going to go penetrate right into that area, okay? And so you can just take one tablespoon of charcoal and just put it in a glass of water and drink that. There's nothing wrong with that. It's not going to hurt you one bit. In fact, we've used it so many times, so many things, especially pain that's associated with inflammation. It knocks it out, I tell you. It's just amazing, the success we've seen with charcoal. I could tell you stories all day of people that have used charcoal. We've used charcoal. We've used it dozens of times. It always works. You don't have to believe in it for it to work, okay? How long you can use it until the problem is gone. And yeah, we had a girl that was a wild with one of our students, and she went off for a camping trip, and a boy was walking in front of her, tripped over some yellow jacket nest, kicked it over, and the swarm just went on her. And she was going into an anaphylactic shock. Her blood pressure went down to 0/0. And it was in the middle of nowhere. Anyway, had to just rub, I think they first used clay and then charcoal. Now, clay is very good. Clay is extremely good. In fact, clay is more effective sometimes than charcoal externally, but not as strong internally. Yeah, my wife, for example, she had mastitis after we had our first child. Charcoal didn't take the pain away, but clay did. I know there are times that there are maybe exceptions to this rule, but generally inflammatory products get released in the blood that charcoal binds to. And so often because there's pain associated with inflammation, inflammation associated with pain, then usually that's where charcoal is the most effective. But you can take a lethal dose of strychnine and take charcoal and not have any side effects. So please don't take my advice on that. But it has been done. yes?
I have a couple of questions.
Yeah.
If you put say you had a boil on your skin, can a charcoal compound do that?
You can use charcoal.
I
may advise you to use something else like cabbage leaf or potato because it can draw it out better sometimes.
Well, there used to be a long time ago, I haven't seen this on the market in a long time, but And you could put it over something like that and you just covered it, you know, like for overnight and it would drop all the infection.
Yeah, right. Yeah, I mean, charcoal isn't the only thing that will do that, but it certainly is the most effective I've seen. Yes?
Could taking charcoal so much can be giving you constipation?
Yes, it can. Yeah, taking charcoal too much can be constipating. And also, I would just throw in a caveat. If your medication is going to neutralize the medication, so 2 hours before, yeah, and it's usually about 2 hours after, yeah.
Is this base good for tetanitis?
Is it good for tetanitis? Yes. Now, I would try it. Why don't you try some? And there's another gentleman. Anyone with inflammation going on? Yeah, please try it, and just. You just get a spoon, and you can put it on here, and just direct application, and then you can tape it or use cellophane. Works well, yeah.
I have two questions.
What type of clay? Okay. just 1 second here. Okay. I'll answer the second question first. What type of clay? You can use French clay, bentonite clay. Bentonite clay is often used. Red clay. Actually, if you go on the website, Mountain Rose Herbs, you'll find some sources of clay there. You just got to be educated into when it's appropriate to use it. Because, you know, personally, if I had some problem internally, my first result would not be clay necessarily. Okay, my first resort may be charcoal. So you just need to know when it's applicable, when it isn't applicable. Some people may have a problem with clay. Sometimes you see animals who are sick, what do? They go and eat some clay. You know, our dog used to do it all the time when he was sick. And clay is very neutralizing as well. And it has a lot of overlap with the effects of charcoal. What was the first question? How long do you use it for?
Well, I'm talking about charcoal now.
Yeah, charcoal.
Arthritis.
Yeah. Well, again, you got to get back to the cause, what's aggravating it. But as a treatment, I would use it until your pain goes away. I mean, you can use these things ongoing. I would combine it with other things. For example, like you could use aloe vera. It's very good for arthritis pain. Yeah. You can just massage it in. Hydrotherapy is very effective for arthritis. And where's Jimmy? Jimmy here? Okay. I've actually got some hydrotherapy pads, some fomentations. I'm limited to how many I have, but they are very, very effective for things like arthritis and pain and problems with congestion and. Anyway, I'll probably talk about that when Jimmy comes here and I can show you how they work. Okay, now we're moving on. So we've done our little psyllium trick. By the way, you can use psyllium with other herbal powders as well. For example, like comfrey. Let's say you've got some bone injury, bone on bone, or you've just broke a bone. You can mix the comfrey powder with the psyllium with a little bit of water, and you can put it straight on, and that will be just as effective as a charcoal. So you can use different herbs for different effects. So which is a great thing about psyllium, because it's ready to use. You know, you want something that's quick. You know, we went to the ER the other day, and a little girl had nursemaid's elbow. A little boy just picked her up. Really like a big bear hug. I mean, and lifted her up, and her arm was like this and wasn't moving. And we thought, oh no, is it broken? She had a hand like this. She's only 16 months old. And so she can't really communicate properly. And so, can you move your fingers? Is, you know, every finger's working? And finally, realized this could be a dislocation problem going on. And they had to take her to the ER. And it took about an hour before we got to see someone. We were in the fast lane. You know, and it's a good thing about having these remedies nearby is, you know, you've got them at your fingertips when something goes wrong. I mean, it's just amazing. If you get burnt, where's that lady that had the burn? Where is she? Okay, how's that feeling?
Soothing.
Okay, good. We put a burn salve on her to try to cool that area. She had a real bad burn there. But, you know, these are things that emergencies come up when we least expect, right? We never plan on them. But if you've got something on hand this quick, now not every emergency can be fixed by natural remedies. Sometimes we do need to go to the hospital. But at least you've got a head start in the process.
So what happened to the baby?
Oh, he's fine. Yeah, sorry. Yeah, we saw one of the PAs there said, you know, I've done this hundreds of times. It hurts the parents more than the children. And he just went like this and flicked it back, and because the ligament was loose, you know, in children all the ligaments are loose and it's easy to pop them out of joint, and so that's what happened. But she was fine. I was getting a bit worried because I had to come here and Didn't want to leave my baby, you know, hanging.
Do you have any remedies for hot flashes?
Yes, I do. I do. In fact, they're out there, and we're gonna get to hot flashes very quickly. Okay. Yeah. Don't worry. I'll be moving like a flash to get there. Okay. Okay. First of all, we still got a lot of ground to cover. We haven't really covered half of what we need to cover. Could I have another volunteer? Not for hot flashes. We'll get there. Don't worry. Whoops. Okay. What we're gonna do now is we're gonna make some elderberry syrup. Elderberry syrup, and this stuff is fantastic. We use this on a daily basis, and my children, they just love elderberry syrup. And well, thank you for coming. All right. Now, all we need for this is some elderberries. Now, we're using the bottom here. It hasn't been contaminated. It's just had water in there. And we're going to get some elderberries. And where's my little cup here? What I would like you to do, what's your name?
Maria.
Maria. Okay, Maria. Thank you. We're going to put a cup of elderberries in this container. Now, what we're making, how are we going? We got it.
I want to work around. You may need to plug in this, the battery for in low.
Okay.
You need to plug it in.
Okay, gotcha.
You want me to print out the
yes, please. That'd be great. Thank you so much.
Okay.
We're going to get some handouts to you. Thank you.
It's all password protected.
Oh, okay. But I'm fine for this now, so I don't need it. Thank you. Okay, so why are we making this? Because every year, colds and flus happen, right? So this is a great protector. I tell you, we have been so blessed in our home for using elderberry. This is a phenomenal recipe. Elderberries have been known to destroy every virus known to man, including AIDS virus. It's amazing stuff. In fact, in flu pandemics, in history past, in Europe and also in different South American countries, they've used elderberry as a last resort when all the medicines have failed. So we've got one cup of elderberries, and we're going to use, you can put them in here, and we've got 4 cups of water, so you can pour that in there. And if you would like to top that, that's quite heavy. You okay with that? We're going to use 4 cups, so 4 parts water to 1 part elderberry. There we go. And I think, yeah, that's a two cups to the top, right? Okay, good. Now, elderberry is also an immune enhancer. Very, very powerful. Now, we'll fill this up again. Okay, good. I think we're about there. Great. And so you can take this any time of the year. In fact, it's good to boost yourself before there's a change of weather. And we're going to mix that in. It's very easy to make this recipe. We're also going to put 1/2 cup of echinacea root. 1/2 cup of echinacea root. So when you're ready with that, yep, we can put that in there. All right. Yeah, let me see now. Is that? Oh, that was 4 cups. So we got 8 cups. I'm sorry, I wasn't paying attention. So what we'll do is we'll make some more. We'll put another cup of elderberries in, and then this probably would be about 1 cup, I think, in here. And echinacea root is the best plant of echinacea, I mean best part of echinacea. And you can use the whole echinacea, you can even use the stem, you can use the flower, but it's really the root that has the most potency. Okay, and so this will stimulate the immune T cell, the killer T cells that destroy the virus. Okay, very, very effective. And also we're going to use ginger. Okay, why do we use ginger? Ginger is a diaphoretic. It will help you to sweat, increase circulation, as well as being good for digestion. And when you have colds and flus, you invariably have congestion. You have pooling of the blood, usually in the thoracic cavity, and you don't get proper good systemic circulation. So when you use ginger, it helps the circulation to increase, and it helps you to sweat. Sweating is one of the best ways to deal with a cold. And so that's why we use it. Yes. That's a great idea. We're going to turn that on. We've got about a cup here of echinacea root. So what I've done now is I've doubled the recipe. So before it was one cup elderberry to four, now it's 2 to 8. So it's the same proportion. Okay, and then we are going to just take, and we don't have to use a lot of ginger. And generally, I don't measure the ginger. You know, you get to know after a while what's going to work. But if you, for those who are really technical, like to stay with the book, okay, you can do about a quarter of a cup. If you're making, if you're making one part to four, like one cup elderberry to four parts water, you can use about a quarter of a cup. Okay, so we're going to actually cut that. If you'd like to chop this up for me now. You don't need to skin it or anything like that. You can wash it first. And I got these from the health food store. And you can just chop it. Okay, so we got a little chopping board here. And Maria, if you'd like to chop this for me. And we're going to put all those little pieces in there. It's going to give it a nice little taste. Now, if you use elderberry by itself, it does not go down as a winner for the children. Okay? It doesn't taste good, to be honest with you. In fact, I'm going to give you some. Jimmy out there? Okay. I'm going to, if you give me 20 seconds, Jimmy, could you get me a bottle of elderberry? Yeah, I'm going to let you try some. Okay? So, did you save your cup, the tea?
Yes.
All right. Maybe I'd like to have... Now, this will virtually go straight in the bloodstream. You know, it doesn't require... It's very, very, very minimum digestion involved in this. There's hardly any digestion involved with it. Yes. Yes, it does. It does have immune support. I just like to give it an extra kick, you know. I like to be aggressive when it comes to getting on top of stuff. Yes? How much do you take? Good question. Now, if you're taking it as a prophylactic, that means as a preventative, you may use 1 tablespoon a day. If you're taking it, thank you very much. If you're taking it as a... Yeah, they have their cups, Jimmy. If you'd like to just pour a little bit, maybe just like a... Well, they're asking too much now. Thank you. If you, yeah, just enough to like have a mouthful, maybe, you know, like a communion type of quantity. She's chopping it. Finally, I think it was fairly thin. She did a good job there. Yeah. And that just gives you more of a surface area. So what we're going to do is we're going to bring this to a boil. Bring this to a boil, okay? So it's going to take a few minutes to bring this to a boil because I've got a slow cook stove here. It doesn't go that quickly. So once... Yes, put the ginger in. Once it brings to a boil, then you let it simmer for about 20 minutes. Okay? Now, elderberries generally you don't want to eat raw, except this variety, which is Sambucus nigra, is the only variety that you can eat raw without any symptoms. Some people have nausea and vomiting. With standard elderberries. Not all elderberries are the same. the elderberries that we have here are different than the elderberries that is from Europe. The European ones, which is the Sambucus nigra, they are the ones that many clinical studies have been done on those type of berries. So that's the one that we use, even though there may not be much difference in the ones
are
that
they like
have here.
Berries?
You can get them freeze-dried, but these don't need freezing. Okay, they are just a dry berry, and
they just harvest them dry. They dry up on the tree, really, when they're ready to go.
Right. So you. Okay, how's that for those who have some? You taste it, okay? Is it right? Yes. And I'm going to get into what sweetener I used. Now, you can use honey. Do you need some tissue? Okay, we got a tissue here. You can use either, what I use is 100% raw honey, untreated honey. And another thing that you can use is vegetable glycerin. Okay, now with the honey, this is the proportion. Most of the ingredients that you use in this is actually honey or glycerin. Now the reason for that is not because we want everyone to have a sweet tooth. It's because it's a preservative. And this is why they use so much sugar in the elderberry syrup that you buy. It's because it's a preservative. And you need at least 2/3 of your content to be sugar-based in order to preserve the elderberry. And so 2/3 honey or vegetable glycerin to that quantity. Now, if you're making 4 cups of water, one part elderberry, after 20 minutes simmering, you're gonna have 2 cups left. So how much honey are you gonna add? 4 cups, right? It's about 2/3. So if you've got, let's say you've got 2 cups of elderberry juice, then you need 4 cups of honey with that. Yeah, so it's, if you have 1 cup, then you add 2 cups of honey. Okay, so 2/3 of your product are either honey or vegetable glycerin. Now, we haven't even got to a boil yet, but it's going to evaporate. I leave the lid off, it will help evaporate it. And it's going to be really, really concentrated. Now, for those who may be wondering, there could be something spiked in there. There was. And it was actually some lemon essential oil and orange essential oil. That was just a few drops. Just a few drops. And with this amount, you only need about 1/2 teaspoon of each one. Okay? Lemon and orange essential oil. They are antiviral of themselves, in their own right. But they also add a little bit of nice tang to it that can hit the child's palate. So I use about 1/2 teaspoon of each one for about 4 cups of the water. Now, it's essential oil. You can swallow this essential oil. There's no harm about it. Yes? How much you take every day? As a prophylactic, about 1 tablespoon. Now, when you have a viral condition, when you feel it onsetting, now I've used this, I don't know how many times. When I've had a cold coming on, if I take like 1 or 2 tablespoons of the elderberry, it will knock it out. Even when you have a cold. Even when you had a flu already, it will knock it out. Now, some people take a little longer to respond. And older people are going to take a little longer to respond. They may take 2 or 3 days to recover. If you're younger, you've got more energy, it could knock it out within 24 hours. Yes?
So a little child is sick, like yours. And you're
right.
How much are we going to give them over here today?
Okay. If it was a child, now, you've got to be careful using honey with an infant. So if they're 1 year or less, some say 18 months, you may want to avoid the honey and go for vegetable glycerin. Now, my little girl, she's only 16 months old. She just downs it. I mean, she just, give me, you know. And that's only because of botulism from honey, which doesn't normally worry us as an older person. But I would use, if they have it, like 2 or 3 teaspoons a day, if they have a cold, or 1 tablespoon would be sufficient. Yes?
What is vegetable glycerin derived from?
It depends. Vegetable glycerin, now, you can make it from soybeans, you can make it from coconut, and what they do is they take the fatty acids and they use water at high pressure with high temperature, and they split the fatty acids off the particular food they're using, oil they're using, and then they use that as a base for the glycerin.
So
it's really fatty acid. Now, I buy non-GMO.
Right.
Yeah, and that's a good point. You got to be careful because a lot of the soybean oil, genetically modified. Now, coconuts, you're safe. Coconuts, they don't GMO. In fact, even if they say organic coconut, all coconuts organic. They don't spray coconuts. Who would climb 40 feet to spray a coconut? So, yes. Yes. How many honey? Well, you're going to have 2 cups of fluid left once you simmer it. So you need 2 times that, right? So whatever you got left, if you got 2 cups, you need 4 cups of honey. Just double it. When you mix it together, it's a third of the overall concentration. But when you're working it out, it's a double. Right.
After,
and it's cooled down a little bit, because you don't use honey you're not cooking in the honey. We're using raw honey, and the last thing you add is the essential oil. Okay. So once this has happened, and you can sit down, Murray, because it's going to take a while. Thank you very much. Once this has started to settle down, simmer, and we've got. Well, here we'll have 4 cups because we used 8 cups. Then, when it's just warm, then you can use the honey, okay? But you have to strain it first because there's all bits in here, right? So we're going to need, where's my strainer? Here we go.
What's the name of the essential oil?
Lemon and orange.
Lemon and orange?
Yeah. So we're going to use a bowl and we're going to pour all the juice over here into a bowl, right? And then, once that's just warm, we'll mix in the honey. And then the last thing we'll add is the essential oil. And then after that, we'll put into a bottle. Make sure you put a label. I tell you, if you don't put a label on, you're going to forget, I tell you. Yes? I've used both. I have glycerin and honey. Some are glycerin only, some are honey. I don't mix the two together.
Okay. Sweet.
Glycerin is very sweet.
Yes.
Now, you don't want to take straight glycerin. It can burn your esophagus. So it does need to be diluted. And it's very strong. But you don't need a lot of elderberry. So it's not like you're having a whole cup of it. It's powerful stuff. It really works. Yes?
How long does it last?
Once it lasts, if you've preserved it correctly, now just keep in mind that when you open it, don't go and swig it. Don't get any germs on the bottle. And make sure you seal it and put it back in the fridge. Don't leave it open because it can turn alcoholic if there's any contamination that's happened on there, even fingertips, even, you know, getting too close to the top there. I sterilize my bottles also before I put the elderberry inside there, because you can get some problems with even, you know, a little bit of contamination. So just keep that in mind. But you can preserve elderberry for, if it's done correctly. I mean, I have elderberry that's a year old and there's no problem. I can take it. But generally speaking, you know, I put on my label 6 to 12 months. But generally speaking, you know, you can go longer than that. It's no problem. But it won't last that long, believe me. Yes. Yes. Not all honeys are created equal. I use a raw, untreated honey. Actually, I didn't bring it with me, but the honeys that you want to use are honeys that you can identify from a flower source. Because, you know, a lot of commercial honey today is actually, it comes from sugar water that they give to bees, and you know, it's not really that good quality, to be honest with you. So try to find a source, like if it says red clover honey or something like that, then you know where it's from. It's actually from a flower, because the act, yeah, orange blossom, another one, yeah. So you know that the active agents that were in the flower are transmitted into the honey. And that's what you want. Because honey is a great preservative, but not only a great preservative, it's also got a great amount of chemicals in itself that assist the body of healing. So I like to use good quality honey, raw honey. If you can get organic raw that's from a flower source, I would recommend that. Okay, so this is going to take a little while, so I'm just going to set that aside for now. Did everyone get to taste it?
Yeah.
Is it right? Good. Okay, so. Well, you see, we cooked that. The elderberries. So, not going to be any nausea, believe me. This is all good stuff. Now, yes?
Well, where we live, we have a lot of elderberry trees wild.
Uh-huh.
Some of the stuff that was not dry,
right?
We use fresh elderberries. Is there any difference other than the sweetness that you'll get?
This is the thing. The clinical studies that have been done on elderberry are from the Sambucus niger in Europe, mm-hmm. not from the American elderberry.
Okay.
So it's not to say the American elderberry is inferior, but we don't know how effective it is. And also, it's not one of those elderberries that you can apparently eat raw, like the Sambucus niger is the only exception for eating raw elderberries. Yeah. Now, you may not have any effect, mm-hmm. and it may be perfectly fine, but some people experience gastric disorders from it. And it depends how much you eat as well, and so, you know, that's a factor.
One more question.
Yes.
What you said about the glycerin and burning the esophagus, is that what's in the glycerin that makes it a good tincture extract process? Because I've never made one with glycerin. I've always used alcohol.
Right. Now, glycerin doesn't act the same way as alcohol. It extracts... it works on extracting different properties. Now, alcohol, what they say is that alcohol can extract certain things that nothing else can extract. Now, that may be true, but I've also always questioned, especially knowing what the Bible says about alcohol, that it could be a blessing come out of that. Now, the devil always works by taking something good and combining it with something bad, right? Or it's partly good and partly bad. And so, you know, just if I knew nothing about science, the science of it, I would still be careful about using alcohol. Because, you know, 10% of alcoholics, they get addicted to alcohol on their first taste of alcohol. Just one mouthful of alcohol can be enough to addict people. This happens in 10% of alcoholics. So I don't want that to occur. So I use vegetable glycerin. I may not get as much extraction out of it, but I'll get more effectiveness out of it. You see, and that's what I'm looking for. And one of these days, I'm going to do some tests on the herbs and see how potent they are compared to other agents. I just bought a Brix meter refractometer, and I was testing the food. Anyone heard of Brix meter? Don't ever buy one, because you'll be so discouraged, you'll wonder how you ever survived eating food out of Walmart or something like that. Okay. So, the nutrient value in food is depreciated to the point that I can't even get any food that virtually scales on good. It's poor or subpoor, you know, even organic. Now herbs can make up the difference with this, and they can supply some minerals that we're not getting in the food. And you don't need a lot of some of the trace minerals that we need. So if you're not getting them from your food, you need to get them from somewhere. Now, of course, supplements have become more popular because we're not getting them from the food. We are lacking the food. And if you're not getting them from a good source, if you don't get enough sunlight outside, you're going to need vitamin D supplementation, right? You got to get it from somewhere. And so it's the same with the phytochemicals and the nutrients in the food. You got to get them from somewhere. So herbs can supply some of that lack that we're missing from even good foods, even fruits and vegetables and grains. Unless you grow them yourself. If you grow them yourself and you know what's going in the soil, then you can get a head start of everyone. Now, one lady asked about menopause. Okay. Boy, which is associated with it. I just made some of this stuff. I mean, just before I came, that was the very last thing I made, hot flashes. You know, the Lord knew where I was heading. But one of the best things for this is what we use, Vitex, black cohosh, and I combine it with what we call St. John's wort, named after St. John, John the Baptist. John the Revelator, I'm sorry. St. John's wort. And you can find this, it's quite common. I don't know if it's in Florida that much, but up where we are, up North Carolina, you can find this common around where we are. In fact, 80% of herbs in the world you can grow where we are. It's a very good climate for it. But this has actually been proven scientifically to be more effective than antidepressants. It's one of the best antidepressants, like Prozac. And it's very, very good for increasing serotonin production. Now, antidepressants, and I don't want to depress anyone when I say this, but they're dangerous to get on, they're dangerous to stay on, and they're dangerous to come off. And you got to be real careful when you're dealing with people with depression, because their serotonin production is limited, their neurotransmitters are all over the place. And they're also on a drug that if you take them off, sometimes they can go into a seizure. And so you got to be really careful with these particular people. They could lose their mind, literally, when they come off their medication. Sometimes it can happen that way. So for those who would like to experiment with it, there's no clinic here, period, that can help people with that, because they don't want to go to conventional, they don't want to be sued by conventional drug companies or, you know, AMA. But there's been enough studies on St. John wort to show that it will help with, mild to moderate depression. There's a reason they don't say severe depression, because they want to keep people on the antidepressants. But it is good if for even severe depression. And we've had people at the Lifestyle Center that have come with a suitcase of antidepressants, and they've gone out without their depressants. You know, so it does work, but you have to be very careful, and you can't pull people off too quickly. You have to moderate it accordingly. But anyway, St. John's wort is a winner. I'm working with a lady right now who's on antidepressants, and it's difficult. You know, I had to explain a few things to her, and she's taken upon herself. She's made that choice to moderate it according as she feels, you know. And so I told her, you know, if you know, it's better to be on the medication and be in your right mind than be, you know, in a psychiatric ward. So just be real careful and take note of what your body's telling you. Yes?
How
do you prepare that? You can make a tea out of that, yes. By the way, let me just tell you something about teas, and then I'll get into extract. A tea is much better than a tablet. It will absorb better. It goes virtually straight in the bloodstream as a tea. Doesn't require much digestion at all, or hardly, actually, sometimes none at all, depending on what you have. So it diffuses very quickly in the bloodstream. So tea is always better. A tablet is like, think of it like canned food. You know, it's not the best. It's, you know, frozen may be a little better, and fresh, of course, is the best, and, you know, dried fruit is great. But a tablet is like the lowest on the scale. Teas are fantastic. Teas do a wondrous job. I mean, they're just powerful to make you feel good. But some people, they need more than the tea. They need it concentrated. And so that's why we have an extract. You concentrate everything in there to a small amount rather than drinking 2 pints of tea a day, right? So what we're going to do is make one of those. Now, Vitex, oh, I wish my wife was here. Vitex, she uses Vitex religiously. She noticed a difference when she doesn't use Vitex. But my wife was, and I know she won't mind me saying this, she was perimenopause at 35 years of age. We couldn't have children. We tried for several years. And she tried Vitex. And she got pregnant, had her first child at 39. We thought that was the first and that was the last. And we had another one, she was about 43 for our second one. Now this was after, several years after she was perimenopause. And even the doctor, OBGYN, said, it's a miracle that you had a child, considering your condition. And she said she is better now than she was 20 years ago. She feels good, she's physically fit, she's got more energy. She doesn't have any PMS. She doesn't have pain. She doesn't have mood swings associated with her cycles. And doesn't have any cramping. And this is very rare today. You ladies are looking, what a lucky lady. Because she had Vitex is the, I tell you, it's one of the world's best secrets for women. I mean, it's amazing. Vitex, V-I-T-E-X. See, it's a hormonal balancer.
Where do you get that?
Well, you can get it from back room. Yeah, we have a back room. I make my own. I can show you how to make it. You know, even though I bring products with me, you can make these things yourself. You know, it's just that I make it. This is my livelihood, so I do this all the time. But you can buy the berry and make it very easily. Chase berry is a hormonal balancer, and if you go online, you see a lot of studies done on chase berry, and it is a winner. It works on the hypothalamus pituitary axis. It balances the endocrine system, and especially things like luteinizing hormone, follicle stimulating hormone, even works on prolactin, and it helps to normalize those cycles. Now, here's the problem with a lot of ladies today, because we've had so much stress in our lives.
Is that the same as
chase berry? It's the same. It's the same thing.
C-H-A-S-T-E.
Chase berry. Or chase tree berry, whichever. It's the same thing. Now, here's the thing. When you have a lot of stress leading up to time of menopause, God designed the adrenal glands to help facilitate the transition into menopause. But because most ladies have had so much stress, their adrenal glands have been exhausted, and when they hit menopause, everything falls apart. You know, their life just falls apart. They go into depression, the estrogen goes down, the BMI goes up, because estrogen balances regulation of weight, and you know, the progesterone gets affected, you know, all kinds of things happen, and it swings moods, it causes fluctuations in body temperature and so on. So what chasteberry does, it helps regulate that. It's not necessarily going to fix all your adrenal problems, but it's going to help aid that transition and stabilize those hormones that are going to give you more control and balance over your, especially the reproductive organs. And for those who would like to have a child or can't have a child, it increases fertility. You know, fertility levels are going down. Do you know that? Yeah. Yes. Oh, thank you. Yes. Pituitary tumor, not necessarily. I wouldn't say it would hurt it, but there's no state I know of that say it will help that, but it doesn't mean it doesn't. It's just that we don't have information on that. Now, flashes. Okay, if you got menopause with flashes, then you need black cohosh. Black cohosh is a herb that will regulate hot flashes. So what I've done is, those who've got just, you know, PMS troubles, you can just use Vitex. But if you've got PMS in combination, menopause with hot flashes, then what I did is I added black cohosh and also St. John's wort. Why did I add St. John's wort? Because it will help regulate the neurotransmission that can lead to depression, especially fluctuations of hormones can lead to depression. Okay, so I combine that in one. But for those who have PMS, yes, you had...
I was using a combination of these things for a friend of mine, and her doctor said, oh, you've got to worry about sun sensitivity with St. John's wort. What is the ratio of that sort of thing?
Yeah, that is actually a myth. Yeah. It's a myth. The sun sensitivity is usually due to the drug medication, mm-hmm. and not so much the herbal right. problem. All right.
Thanks for discussing.
Yeah, you can go online. There's current information on light that debunks St. John's wort with sun sensitivity. Yes?
The menopause formula that you have in the back, 16-ounce bottles, it doesn't say.
It doesn't say on there. I'll tell you why it doesn't say, because I didn't have time. I was doing this last minute, and I didn't put it down there. But I can give you the ratio if you're interested. Oh, okay. It didn't say. Okay. This is what I do. What I recommend. If it was me, okay. If it was me, aren't you happy? I don't know. May have some hot flashes from time to time, right, man? Okay. But what I suggest, and I use the same for Vitex. Is 2 teaspoons a day. It's very concentrated because it's an extract. And when I make an extract, I use a crock pot. Now, I use more of a commercial type, you know, setup than this, but this will help you, you know, everyone has virtually got one of these at some point. The only problem with these is the lowest setting is not low enough. It's 150, and you know, they say that you want to keep it about no more than 130. But what I do is I put it in a crock pot for 3 days. 3 days, and it extracts everything out of that in 3 days. There's really nothing else left after that to get out of the mix. So I use a crock pot, and I put, and I'm going to show you how to do this. I put the Vitex in here. So what I do is I get a kettle. Excuse me, if I can just get my kettle here. I get a kettle and I fill this up with some hot water. Now you can do it a number. Let's see, which one shall I take out?
I'm so sorry, what are you making? What are you doing?
I'm going to make some chase berry formula that is going to help for PMS. And how this relates to hot flashes is I add two other ingredients to help hot flashes. But this is my basic formula for ladies' hormonal problems. Chase berry, it's a winner. So what you do is you get, this is a pint jar. You put about half. I use a little bit less than half. I have my reasons for that, but you can almost fill this up to half with the berry itself. Okay, so I'm gonna do this real quick. Let's see if I got a cup somewhere. That's right. It's the same. It's the same word, chase berry and Vitex. Same berry. All right. Why it's called chase berry is because it was used by monks for, you know, controlling their sexual desires. And but don't worry about that, because if you're low, if you're not a monk, that's right. If you're low, it will normalize that, and if you're too high, it will reduce that. So it's a hormonal normalizer, and men can use it too.
It controls your libido.
It controls the libido, yes. It's very good. Yeah, it does. And here we have the berries. See, the berries are very similar to elderberry, except the elderberries are more purple and slightly bigger. Oh, by the way, I forgot to tell you. If I'm going too fast and there's just so much information and you want to learn more about this, we actually did a natural remedies seminar a few months ago, and we recorded. We had some of the best Adventist doctors and experts in natural remedies come. And anyway, we put it on DVD. And we have those DVDs back. It's like a little mini course, and it covers about 40 hours, something like that, of lots of practical stuff for like hydrotherapy and herbs. And there's some DVDs here in the other room. So if you want to do some more study, we had Agatha Thrash come, we had Dr. Grievous, we had Dr. Jackson, we had some real good experts, we had a herbalist came. Practical herbalist, and so we recorded that, and it's really good to go over that material. Everyone was blessed when they came. Now, I'm just waiting right now for this to boil, this kettle. Once this kettle is boiled, what I'm going to do is I'm going to fill this up to around half. These berries are going to elevate, they're going to float a little bit, and then I'm going to stir that up. Okay, I'm going to let that sit for about 15 minutes. Okay, and that hot water is going to extract some of those properties. It's going to swell the berry and make it more susceptible for the cells to rupture so that the phytochemicals and nutrients can come out the berry. And then we're going to top it up with some vegetable glycerin. After we've done that, we're going to put a cap on it. And then put it in the crock pot. The crock pot needs to be filled with water. All right? And usually when I do it, I do multiple jars. So I'll do a lot together and I'll fill the whole thing. So I'll do the jars first and then put the water in, because of course you put the water in first, jars overflow. So, and then leave it for 3 days. Now, if you want a quick approach and you just don't want to wait 3 days, you can do the same thing we did for the elderberry. You bring it to a boil, the water to a boil, you let it simmer for about 20 minutes, then you strain it, put it in a jar, but you're going to have to drink about a cup of it, a cup per day, okay? So when you make an extract out of it, you only need about 2 teaspoons of it a day. Now, as your body adjusts, now some ladies, when you see the reports, now I think this is maybe a little bit exaggerated, but they say some ladies take up to 6 months to respond. Now, from my personal experience, I've seen it usually is within 1 to 2 weeks from what I've seen. I don't think I've seen anyone outside of that at this point. But if you're really deficient, it may take a little longer. Now, once you've been taking it for a while, guess what? You may need less over time. You may get away with 1 teaspoon a day because your body's responding better. And this works, I tell you, it works. If you take Vitex, I love to hear reports of Vitex. You know, ladies are suffering, they've got so many pains. I mean, it's bad enough without these cramps and pains and everything. But, you know, we're just living in a society that's producing so much stress, got so much bad food, got so much problems today that, you know, it's just hurting ladies much more than it used to. So, you can go through a period without knowing you've got a period if you're on Vitex. I'm serious. You can go through a period without knowing you've got a period. Yes? This container, this is a pint, half a quart. So it's boiled now. So I'm going to fill this, cover this up. It's floating a little bit. That's okay. And then I'm going to get a spoon. Now, I don't normally do this because it's plastic. So imagine it's silver. And I just mix it together. Mix it really good so there's water around it. And then once you do that, just add a little more. And it floats a little bit. So it's getting now, it's about half, maybe just a touch over half now. And it's immersed in water. Okay, so I let that sit for 15 minutes. After I let that sit 15 minutes, then I'm going to get this vegetable glycerin and fill this up with the rest. Then I stir it. Stir it really good. And then, see, it's already coming up. Okay. This is starting to penetrate through, and the phytochemicals are starting to come out. So this is pure vegetable glycerin. Fill this up, give it a good stir, put the lid on, then I put it in the crock pot. After it comes out of the crock pot for 3 days, then what do you have to do next? Strain it. Strain it, and then you put it in a little container. Now, okay, we got boiling going on here with the elderberries. That's great. So I'm gonna turn that down now. So once we've strained it, I pour it in a bottle like this. Now, the bottles that I have in the other room there, normally when you see a tincture, you have a dropper. Well, they only make droppers for like 1 ounce or 2 ounce bottles. So what I did, because I knew that that wouldn't last very long, so I put a cap on and just put a teaspoon. But it's a very, very concentrated product, okay? It's more concentrated than a concentrate. Okay, so you don't need to have a cup of this stuff. You just need a teaspoon. Well, teaspoon twice a day is what I would do. It's up to you what you do. Okay, yes.
Okay, back to the crock pot. You said that they're typically a little hotter. Mine is runs hotter too.
Yeah.
But you can still use it, you're saying?
You can still use.
I have a question. If it gets hot, you've got a lid on that jar. Is it going to seal it?
Yeah, I use a canning jar, but here's what I do. Here's a trick I do. I get a little heating pad, and I put that in the crock pot so it doesn't crack the jar. And it provides...
Like a cloth?
Yeah, thick cloth. Yeah.
Pot holder, cloth.
Just put that at the bottom of the crock pot.
It's not going to bring to boiling point.
Boiling point is like over 200 degrees. But it will. I found personally, I've still used it in a crock pot, but now I have one that's it's better at thermal control. So I use that. But you know, it still will work. Put it that way.
Have you ever tried it in an oven?
No, because you see, oven is dry heat. Whereas you've got water, you want the.
I was thinking in a pan with water.
You
have to keep adding water.
Yeah, it's a little more difficult, and you know, if you come up, I mean, you sound like you're creative, so you may be able to come up with something. If you do, give me a call.
Okay.
I'm always looking for new ways to improve. Yes. Yeah, put water in the crock pot. Exactly. How much? Till it's above the top of the jar. So, you know, I do it till about here. Because a lot of the crock pots, you can't go too high because, you know, it will spill over, and if you move it, it's problematic. Well, I think our time is sort of coming to a close. I can't believe how quickly time has gone today. Now, handouts did... You passed out. There's extra handout. Now, let me just explain about the handouts. The handouts have some of the recipes, like making a salve and things like that. Has the ingredients you could use. Thank you very much. There are certain things that I've said that aren't necessarily on here, but, you know, it helps you to get started. Yes?
Okay, I get it. Once you put the vegetable, like glycerin.
Yes? You leave it for 3 days after that. So
and
when you put
the... You put it in the crock pot?
No, you put it in the crock pot for 3 days.
For three days.
Yeah.
Do you have to keep adding water?
To the crock pot, you may have to add water. But if you got a lid, generally, I don't have to add water. But you stir it. Just give it a stir. And every day, you can get the container and give it a shake. It just adds a little bit of extra, you know, mix, so you get even more even distribution. Did you want to announce about the lunch? Oh, check my schedule. Oh, 12:30 would be fine. Is that okay for you? We could do that. Yeah, actually, make it 12:45. Would that be too late? Okay. We're going to have lunch at 12:45. The lady's getting it all ready. If you have any other questions, you can come and see me. For those who are not interested in making their own or anything, we have some things in the back room there. If anyone would like a program, maybe you're from another area, another church or something, and you want something similar to this, I'd be willing to come back another time. So let me know, and I can. Oh, let me give you my contact information, because my business card's got the wrong number on it now. So let me give you my phone number, and I'll give you my email address. And if you have any questions or you want to contact me, you can do this. Please don't give my. I do have on some of my labels, I have my email address, but my phone number is 828-545. That's 828-545-6049. Yeah, Western, South, yeah. Okay. And then my email is Lee, L-E-E, L-E-E dot H-H-P, H for Harry, H for Henry, P for Paul, at gmail.com. Lee dot H-H-P at gmail.com. Dot is a period, that little, not D-O-T. Lee dot H-H-P at gmail.com. Phone number 828-545-6049. And so if you're from another church, you like a program like this, let me know. I can book it in advance and we can come down and do another program. Wellard. It's W-E-L-L-A-R-D. A for Apple, R for Roger, D for Dog. Or Americans call me Wellard. English Wellard, but it doesn't matter. Either way, we're good to go. They can stay here and we can go over there when things are ready, so you can come back and let me know.
At 12:45.
Yep.
Okay.
Good.
I hope that everybody can stay here for lunch at 12:45. We have plenty of food, lots of varied varieties of soups, vegan sandwiches, and special healthy desserts.
Mm.
You don't want to miss this. And
that's good.
Crunchy veggies, so stay by at 12:45 because we have tons of food and we don't want anybody to leave because we need you all to eat.
Amen. Amen.
So stay around, listen to more information, and at 12:45, please come back over to the fellowship hall right over here.
Yeah, thank you.
Yeah,
we can do it over there. Yeah, we can do it over there. But I would like to close with a word of prayer, if that's okay. Let's pray. Father in heaven, we're so thankful you've given herbs for the service of man, as you've said in your word. And Father, we pray that you'll help us to use this knowledge intelligently to help ourselves, our families, and others, that we can further your kingdom and be in health and prosper, as your word says. Bless us with your blessing and give us the insight, understanding, and wisdom how to intelligently apply natural remedies so we can be better examples, live healthier, longer lives for you. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
Okay. Yeah, maybe we could take a couple more. Oh, as long as people eat. Oh, thank you for reminding me. I just want to make an announcement. I have a lot of books at the back here, and whatever price is in the books, you cut it in half. We're selling the books half price. So there's some really good books out there, and I've got too many books. And so we're just moving. So there's some really good cool books and natural remedy books out there. So. Plus, we got DVDs. We've also got hydrotherapy pads that are very hard to get hold of, and also some herbal tincture extracts like Vitex and different things like that. So, yeah. So, thank you for coming, and
thank you. Hope you
can be blessed. Thank you.
Because I say one thing, I'll say we put it going back to the basics.